Good evening and welcome to Your Call. It's the only program where you, the viewer, can ask your questions directly to our newsmaker of the week. Tonight, a man who stood tall throughout his entire career, one of the finest judicial minds of our country, someone who stood for integrity and defending the principles of our constitution. Joining me now is the former Chief Justice of India and the former head of the National Human Rights Commission, Justice JS Verma. Justice Verma, thank you very much for coming in, sir. We look first at the highlights of your life and career. Justice Verma, coincidentally, this week brought back memories of an event in which you played an important role in the aftermath. That's in your role as chairman of the National Human Rights Commission, when you actually visited Gujarat. And your report, I think, brought out an unbiased view for many of what was happening there. When you see 9 years later what is currently happening, a Supreme Court verdict which is being interpreted by some as a vindication, as the passing of an Agni Pariksha, what would you like to tell people today?
Well, I think this confusion is absolutely unwarranted. And the mere fact that the matter should still not be finally resolved and the perpetrators of the egregious human rights violations still go unpunished, well, that's something which disturbs me, as it would disturb every reasonable person in our country.
You think the delay has been unconscionable?
Well, it should not have been there. I like to put it the mildest, should not have been there. And the delaying tactic should not have succeeded.
In fact, sir, I have a question for you from someone who is involved in the case, the son of Ehsan Jafri, who was killed in Gurbarg, Tanveer Jafri, who wants to ask you this question.
For victims, it is a lonely battle. For their family, it is a lonely battle. What relief Supreme Court can provide for victims of mass violence in the interest of the justice?
There's always a danger when you move against the chief minister, the elected chief minister of a state, especially in Gujarat, where Mr. Modi has won 3 successive elections. How do you balance that worry? We've seen the recent case when affidavit was filed, where a collusion was alleged between the prosecution and the defense in Gujarat riot cases. What would you say, sir, as a former Chief Justice?
In that case, I think I should not express my opinion about that and leave it to the Supreme Court to decide. But even if there is a slightest if there is a reasonable doubt that the trial will not proceed as expeditiously as possible, there would be obstacle, then certainly the cases must be transferred out. And I would be happy if they are transferred out.
Well, I think that's a significant statement, sir. Someone we interviewed a short while ago had mentioned to me that when you talk about the Supreme Court, politicians are worried about the People's Court. And we've said that in many ways that what happened in Gujarat may well have been obliterated if the people involved in Narendra Modi's won election after election after election. And not as a judicial person, but as the former chairman of the National Human Rights Commission, what would you say?
I'll tell you, I was in the NHRC when probably the first election was one after these communal violence. And a group of foreigners from all walks of life, they came and they said that, see, in spite of this, this is what has happened. My answer was simple. I said, what happened in Gujarat alone does not depict what will happen in whole of India. And I said, Gujarat is a part of India, but not whole of India. And you know what happened in 2004. The general impression is that 2004 parliament elections were largely influenced, you see, and the change was largely influenced at the center because of Gujarat.
You met the then chief minister at that time. What was that meeting like, sir?
Well, it was certainly not pleasant for him. That's what I can say. I don't want to divulge what I said, but I did say everything very bluntly, and not only that, you see. And, of course, he promised to make all amends, because, according to me, one principle alone is sufficient. you see, in this connection. The question is not the need to prove active conspiracy or complicity or involvement.
Mm-hmm.
You see, we laid down in those orders which I mentioned first April 31st May, that the mere fact that there is violation on a large scale, egregious violation of human rights within the territory of a state, within the jurisdiction of a state, the state is liable. Because the duty of the state is not merely to punish violations after they occur, but to prevent the happening of these violations. And it is no answer for the state, who is responsible for governance, to say that this was not done by the state players or state agents.
Mm-hmm.
If the duty is to prevent, then the duty of the state is to see no one within the jurisdiction, by any act or omission, you see, commits a violation of human rights.
NDTV's cricket app, Android and iPhone. Fastest scorecard, special analysis, and much more. Download free. NDTV.com/apps.